speaking of 80s and 90s music, it figures large in sort of an off-Broadway play that I read about in the Washington Post. And it's called, this play is called AD 16. AD 16. And what's it all about? Well, it's about the alleged romance between Jesus and Mary Magdalene. It's Valentine's Day, so I thought I'd share this with you because this is the most untrue love story of all time. A lot of true love stories out there. This isn't one of them. This rumor has persisted for so long. It goes back a ways. In recent years, because of books like The Da Vinci Code, has come to the fore once again. I'm going to address that whole issue because it's more than just this particular off-Broadway play. But just to tell you a little bit about this production that's going on, it was written by a guy named Cinco Paul. And he's also the creator, by the way, of Schmigadoon. I don't know if you were an Apple TV Plus subscriber, but I haven't seen this thing, but apparently it's a send-up of 1940s musicals. It's called Schmigadoon. He also co-wrote the animated film The Secret Life of Pets. He was a screenwriter for the Despicable Me franchise. And so he's really the brains behind this play called AD 16. And it's kind of about a teenage crush that Mary Magdalene has on Jesus. I don't know whether they're both supposed to be 16 years old at the time. I don't know why it's called AD 16. I haven't seen the thing. I just read about it. But it's on stage right now. It's something called the Olney Theater Center, which is in the Washington, D.C. area through March the 6th. And it features a lot of songs that are inspired by 80s and 90s R&B songs. So a lot of big names are involved with this production. There's a writer named Becca Brunstetter who worked on the TV show This Is Us. She kind of helped write the script on this. Broadway directors are sort of helming this show. It was kind of delayed because of the pandemic, but now it's finally in front of an audience. And so there's a song that's kind of the main theme song here for this production of AD 16. It's called Perfect. And of course, it's kind of about when Mary Magdalene first meets Jesus and she's convinced that he's perfect. And of course, she has no idea just how perfect he is. He's the divine Son of God. So that's what it's about. I can't tell you if it's like really blasphemous or not. Again, I haven't seen it. But this trope, this idea that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were lovers, what is this all about and where is this from? Well, there's a lot of reasons why people think this. I'm going to try to give you one reason why, just so you know the background. There is no historical basis for this whatsoever. But a lot of it comes back to what are called the apocryphal gospels. The apocryphal gospels. They're also called the extra-canonical gospels, or outside of the canon of scripture. As you might know, there were some other gospels that were floating around in the first few centuries of the church, but they got excluded from the Bible. Now, these tend to paint a very different picture of Jesus from what you see in the New Testament. And the charge that's often leveled at the church is that, well, the church is trying to hide these books from you because they contain things in them that they don't want you to know. For example, this idea that Mary Magdalene and Jesus were secret lovers or something like that. And there's a whole bunch of other stuff we could say about this too. So that's the allegation that the church wants to hide the truth from you. Therefore, they didn't make it into the Bible, but now we're here to tell you the truth. Is that legitimate? Well, in a word, no, it's not. And by the way, I'm not afraid of these books, and you shouldn't be either. And what I always tell people is exactly what my professors told me, like people like Dr. Craig Evans, who's a great friend of the show. He always said, look, if you want to know why these extra-canonical gospels, these apocryphal gospels, were not included in the biblical canon, just read them. Just read them. Go ahead. I'm not trying to save you from them. You can look them up. You can Google them. They're all over the internet. You can read them. And these are books like the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Peter, the Gospel of the Nazareans, the Gospel of the Egyptians, the Gospel of the Hebrews, the Gospel of Mary. We'll talk about that in just a second. That has a lot to do, obviously, with Mary Magdalene. So when you read these apocryphal gospels, most people, when they take a look at them, they wind up saying, well, there's a good reason why the church. I mean, I'm a non-expert, they say, but even I can tell that these are bogus. These just don't ring true. They don't have, you know, I'll give you a $5 word here, verisimilitude. And that simply means they don't cohere with the truth. They don't cohere with veritas. They don't seem legitimate. They don't make any sense with respect to the time, the place where Jesus actually lived in the first century. And you might know there's some so-called infancy gospels of Christ too, and they'll contain fanciful stories like Jesus turning a bully into a statue, you know, into a stone statue, taking clay birds and making them real. There's one apocryphal gospel where Jesus and his buddies are kind of playing soccer on this rooftop, on top of a house. One of the kids falls off, dies. Jesus brings him back to life. All kinds of. There's even one where, you know, Joseph has to kind of go to Home Depot to get some supplies. They're working in the carpentry shop together. Young Jesus, he's about, you know, 12 years old, 13 years old. Joseph's like, look, we're out of wood here. I got to go get some lumber. I'll be back. Can you mine the shop for me, Jesus? Yeah, no problem, Dad. So Joseph goes, and Jesus just decides to take a rest on the hammock, just kind of kicks back and has a little nap. And meanwhile, the saw is sawing on its own. You know, the plane is planing on its own. All the machines are working. All the implements are doing their own thing as if by magic. And Joseph comes back and sees that Jesus is doing this. Ah, son, you did it again. It's that kind of stuff. Or Joseph is making a bed for this king. Oh man, this guy's really tall. I goofed. He's 6'7". I only made the bed 5'9". Jesus says, no problem, Dad. And he just kind of stretches the wood. You know, it's a miracle on demand. The bed now fits. Okay, Jesus certainly did miracles. You can't separate Jesus from the miraculous. But these sort of nonsensical tales aren't very convincing, to say the least. And so that's the kind of stuff that we're dealing with when we look at these apocryphal gospels. And I want to talk to you a little bit about one of them. And this is the one that gets a lot of play and leads to things like this play called AD 16, which is allegedly about the teenage romance or the teenage infatuation that Mary Magdalene has with Jesus, talked about in the Washington Post. Well, let me talk to you about another recent media item. It was a book that came out. Now, you might have heard of this. This gets a lot of attention and has over the years. Dan Brown actually drew from this work when he wrote The Nonsensical Da Vinci Code. It's a book called Holy Blood and Holy Grail that was written by Michael Bagent, Richard Lee, and Henry Lincoln. And this came out in the year 1982. And these guys would want to tell you that they did a lot of careful historical research, that they discovered the truth about Jesus and Mary Magdalene. In fact, they were lovers. They had children. They had children, yes. And these children, or the children of those children, eventually got to southern France, and they married off into noble families. And that's where the French Merovingians came from. So have you ever heard of the Knights Templar? You probably at least heard of them. The Knights Templar, the Priory of Sion, and that's a secret society that was founded in the year 1099. They knew about all this, and they did everything in their power to keep it all a secret. The fact that Jesus had a family, had this dynasty, they wanted to protect the descendants, the real-life descendants of Jesus and Mary. So grand masters of this Priory of Sion included Leonardo da Vinci, Isaac Newton, and Victor Hugo, the author of Les Miserables. So that's what's being alleged here. Now, how on earth did these guys find all this information? How did they discover this? Well, they found some of the secret papers of the Priory of Sion hidden away in the Bibliothèque Nationale of France, the National Library of France. They also apparently found important clues in artwork and legends that were associated with Rennes Le Château. Okay, now, everything I just told you, no credible historian believes a single word of it. And there's a good reason for that. The whole thing is a hoax. It's an absolute hoax. And the people behind the hoax, they've already admitted that it's a hoax. Michael Bagent, one of the writers of Holy Blood and Holy Grail, he knew it was a hoax. And that didn't stop him from going ahead, though, and publishing this book. By the way, this hoax was kind of foisted upon everybody back in 1956. There were rumors that there were all these valuable documents found at Rennes-le-Château, along with treasure, all kinds of riches. So there's this guy named Pierre Plantard. He exploited all these rumors. He's the one who kind of created this hoax. And he even forged some French and Latin documents and planted these, secretly planted these in the National Library of France. And by the way, you can find images of these documents on the internet. So eventually these guys who started this hoax admitted it under oath in court, in a French court of law. In fact, Pierre Plantard actually served time in jail for fraud. He died in the year 2000. So there's been a book exposing this hoax. It was published by a guy named Bill Putnam, who's an archaeologist, and John Edwin Wood. The book is called The Treasure of Rennes-le-Château, A Mystery Solved. That book came out in 2003. But anyway, so that's all kind of backdrop to Holy Blood and Holy Grail. So Michael Bagent and Richard Lee also published, not only did they do Holy Blood and Holy Grail, they published a book called The Dead Sea Scrolls Deception in 1991. That also is a book that's super problematic. Lots of historical inaccuracies, lots of rumors, lots of innuendo. And they kind of capitalize on the fact that some of the Dead Sea Scrolls, they weren't published on time. There was a bit of a delay in publication. And so these guys are saying, well, the reason why these Dead Sea Scrolls weren't published on time is because, guess what? The scrolls contain some very damaging truths that would just be embarrassing for the church. So they want to say that these unpublished Dead Sea Scrolls contain all kinds of facts that lend support to their theory about Jesus. Well, these guys have, these scrolls have nothing to do with Jesus, okay? None of the Dead Sea Scrolls do, because they're not Christian documents, in case you didn't know that. But they do kind of shed some light on what was going on at the time of Jesus in the first century, leading up to that time. Anyways, the bottom line is Holy Blood, Holy Grail, everything written by Michael Bagent, Richard Lee, it's not history. It's pseudo-history. Legends, hoaxes, rumors. They used all the stuff to make a fairy tale about Jesus and Mary Magdalene and the early church. But everybody loves a good conspiracy theory, right? So these books have sold really, really well. And it's not surprising that a lot of people buy into these theories. And one of the people who did buy into these theories is none other than Dan Brown, who, of course, wrote The Da Vinci Code. Some other writers have sort of, Margaret Starbird is another person who's written some stuff based on all this. But Dan Brown accepts without question almost anything that was put forth in Holy Blood and Holy Grail, and as well as almost everything in the Dead Sea Scrolls Deception book. But by the way, Michael Bagent and Richard Lee, they actually sued Dan Brown and Dan Brown's publisher for stealing intellectual property, because they basically said he stole all of his ideas from us. Brown also took some a whole bunch of ideas from other dubious sources, added a bit of his own stuff into the mix. There are tons of errors in his book. And at the front page of the Da Vinci Code book, if anybody's ever read it, and it's not even a good book like by literary standards, but he's got this fact page at the start of the Da Vinci Code, and he lists all these alleged facts. They're all not true. They're all not true. But anyways, there's so much that could be said here. Leonardo da Vinci's portrait of the Last Supper, which he painted in about 1497. In the book, there's a lot of stuff about, who was the person to the right of Jesus at the Last Supper in that famous portrait? Well, Dan Brown says, well, it's got to be Mary Magdalene. Why? Because this is the only person at the table who doesn't have a beard. So it has to be a woman. Well, art historians say that it's not actually Mary Magdalene. It's John, the beloved disciple, who, of course, was very, very young. He was a teenager when he started following Jesus. That's why he doesn't have a beard. It's because he's a youth. All right, so there's all kinds of stuff that we could say about this. So all of the stuff in there is a hoax. So, where does this idea originally come from, that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were lovers? Okay, if this whole batch of stuff was made up, that eventually got into Holy Blood and Holy Grail, it was all based on a hoax, and that eventually got into the Da Vinci Code, that was based on a hoax. Well, where did the idea actually come from? There's two of these apocryphal gospels, or gospels that didn't make it into the Bible, because they're not scripture. They don't tell us anything about Jesus and his times. They're not a good reference for the historical Jesus. There are two documents in particular that kind of stand out on this front. One is called the Gospel of Philip. The other one is called the Gospel of Mary. Okay, these are not first century documents. Again, they don't shed any light on Jesus. The Gospel of Mary was probably written in the year 160 AD, and the Gospel of Philip was written kind of around that time as well. So the Gospel of Philip, here's a line from the Gospel of Philip, and here's what it says. It says, the companion of dot, dot, dot. And the reason why I say dot, dot, dot is because the text breaks off. We don't know what the text actually says. There's some missing words in the fragments that have been found. So it says, the companion of the dot, 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 Mary Magdalene, something, 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 her more than the disciples, something, 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 kiss her, blank, 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 on her, dot, dot, dot. We don't know. So we don't know what it actually says. So, but most people think this is probably what this line said in the Gospel of Philip. If you want to reconstruct it, fill in the missing words, here's probably what it says. It probably says, the companion of the Savior is Mary Magdalene, but Christ loved her more than all the disciples and used to kiss her often on her, we don't know. So some people want to fill in the blank and say, well, it must have said, he used to kiss her often on her mouth or on her lips. Well, we don't know that. We don't know that that's what the text said. Maybe he kissed her on her hand or on her head. At any rate, they weren't romantically in love. Because don't forget that in the Bible, in the time of the Gospels, a kiss wasn't always a romantic thing. A kiss could show respect. Don't forget, when Judas betrayed Jesus, right? Remember, he betrayed him with a kiss, because it was very common for a rabbinical student, for a disciple, to give their teacher, their master, a kiss of respect. And that's exactly what happened. And we see this sometimes even today in some cultures. In Italy, for example, some people, friends, relatives, they'll greet each other, hey, ciao bella, you know, a kiss on the cheek. I don't know if that's what they say, but anyways, you know what I'm talking about. So the idea that, okay, well, maybe Jesus, you know, maybe gave her a little kiss on the head, she was his disciple, that sort of thing, that doesn't mean that they had a romantic relationship. But at any rate, this Gospel of Philip, is not a good source about the historical Jesus anyways. But it does not say, even if it were legitimate, it doesn't say that Jesus and Mary were lovers. People want to read that into it, but that's not what it says, okay? All right, so we're going to take a little break here, but there's one more of these apocryphal gospels, these untrustworthy documents that people want to use to say that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were Valentines. It's called the Gospel of Mary. Maybe you've heard of it. It was in the news a lot recently. I'm going to talk to you about that after the break. Hey, if you have a take on this, 888-914-9149, you can call me right now on the Cale Clarke Show. We'll be right back.
Your mind off traffic and on the more important things in life. It's Cale Clarke on Relevant Radio.
Hey, welcome back to the program. 888-914-9149. Had a wonderful conversation with Rich Gannon about the Super Bowl and the inspiring faith-filled figure of Cooper Kupp, who won MVP in that game last night. If you missed that, if you missed the stuff we were talking about earlier just before the break, this off-Broadway play that's called AD 16, alleging a teenage infatuation love relationship between Mary Magdalene and Jesus. That's a persistent rumor. I'm in the process of debunking that right now. If you missed any of that, you can always download the podcast. It'll be out about an hour after the program, relevantradio.com and the app. And once again, we want to thank everybody who donated through the app, through the website, relevantradio.com. You can still do that, by the way, if you missed out on our Give from the Heart pledge drive last week, which was very successful. You guys came through once again. Our listeners are just the best. And we met our goal. We met our target. Wanted to let you know that. Thank you so much for making that happen. We do this every quarter. Keeps us on the air on our almost 200 radio stations in the United States and all around the world using the magic of the internet. Well, one thing you can look up on the internet is an apocryphal gospel called the Gospel of Mary. It didn't make it into the Bible for very good reason. It's not a good source. It's not a credible source of information about Jesus or Mary Magdalene, but it's one of the documents that people try to point to try to say that they had a love relationship, that they were lovers, that they were, you know, maybe married. And I talked just before the break about how Dan Brown, the author of the Da Vinci Code, got sued by these other guys for basically, you know, stealing their stuff, their legends and rumors about Jesus and Mary Magdalene, which they in turn stole from a proven hoax. Okay, all these fake documents that were allegedly kept secret for many, many years, that Jesus and Mary Magdalene got married, had kids, founded a dynasty. There's all kinds of stuff out there. None of it is true. You don't need to worry about any of it. But it's good to know about it in case you ever hear about this, because it does tend to come up, especially at Easter time. You know, very often there'll be TV programs, internet websites, articles that say, yes, Jesus and Mary Magdalene had a relationship and the church is trying to suppress this, doesn't want you to know about it. It's not true. It's not true. Okay, so let me tell you about this Gospel of Mary. This is another apocryphal gospel. It's not in the Bible. It's from the same period of time, roughly, as the Gospel of Philip. Okay, I'd say the Gospel of Philip is maybe dated to 150 AD. The Gospel of Mary, it's probably about 160 AD. That's where scholars tend to date it. Now, just to give you some context here, I personally think that the four Gospels in the New Testament were all written prior to the year 70 AD. So why do I say that? Well, because not one of them mentions the destruction of the temple. Now, Jesus prophesies it, but they don't mention that the temple is lying in ruins. No document in the New Testament does. I actually think the entire New Testament was written before 70 AD. Now, some say these documents were written a little bit later. That's fine. It doesn't really affect the argument at all. Because don't forget, Paul's letters were written before the four Gospels. So he tells us a lot of stuff about Jesus that's even earlier than that. So all of these things were written while eyewitnesses were still alive and could sort of come to the fore and say, hey, that didn't really happen. Okay, so very, very good historical, credible documents. They're great sources of information about the historical Jesus, the four Gospels of the New Testament. Anyway, so this Gospel of Mary survives in two fragments that have been discovered. Three fragments. Two of them are Greek fragments, and another one is Coptic. It's kind of Egyptian. So anyways, in the Gospel of Mary, Mary Magdalene shares with the disciples things that Jesus taught her that the other disciples never got to hear. So here's a quote from the Gospel of Mary. Peter says to Mary, "Sister, we know that you were much loved by the Savior as no other woman. Therefore, tell us what words of the Savior you know, what we have not heard." Okay, and then for the next little while in the Gospel of Mary, Mary tells the disciples stuff that's very similar to what you'll see in the writings of a cult called the Gnostics. Okay, these were people who split off from the church. They had all these weird esoteric teachings, not Catholicism. Okay, it's very much divergent. These are people who kind of left the church and kind of did their own thing, had these secret clubs, and you had to join their secret clubs to get in on the inside scoop. That's not the Catholic faith. The Catholic faith is all public revelation. It's not a secret at all. Now, when she's done talking, when Mary Magdalene is done talking about all this stuff, Andrew, Peter's brother, says, "I don't buy any of this stuff. I don't think Jesus ever told you any of this stuff." And Peter says, yeah, I think you're right, Andrew. I think she's actually lying to us. And then Mary Magdalene starts crying and she says, quote, do you think that I have told lies about the Savior? And then Levi, that's Matthew, of course, Levi says to Peter, Peter, anger always lies within you, and now you are questioning the woman. If the Savior regarded her as worthy, who are you to despise her? For that one, having known her, loved her always and assuredly. Okay, so again, I this is not a legitimate gospel. I'm just telling you what's actually in this document, because people want to try to use this to say that Jesus and Mary had a relationship. So the point here is it's all about Mary's qualifications as a disciple. It's not about her being in a romantic relationship with Jesus. So in the story, Peter is mad because Jesus seems to put Mary on a higher pedestal than him, okay, the first pope. Now, when Peter says, or sorry, when Levi says to Peter, hey, if Jesus said she was worthy, why are you despising her? After all, he knew her. Okay, that doesn't mean that they had relations, okay, like in the biblical sense of knowing the person, okay, as it says in Genesis. Okay, that has nothing to do with that. So what this is all about is this idea of having full knowledge. These Gnostic cults that left the church, and this is a very Gnostic document, they always said, oh, we have the true knowledge, or gnosis. That's where the word Gnostic comes from. We've got the real inside scoop on Jesus. Those Catholics, they really don't have that. You should join our little group. So that's what it's really all about. This has nothing to do with romance. It's a fake gospel written by a cult. It has nothing to do with the historical Jesus, the historical Mary Magdalene, nothing to do about any kind of relationship. There's nothing there. And just to go back to the Da Vinci Code for 1 second. So Dan Brown has this character in the book, Sir Lee Teabing. Okay, if you've seen the movie or read the book. Now that name, Sir Lee Teabing, that actually is kind of an amalgam of Richard Lee and Michael Bagent. Okay, he's kind of smashing those names together to make Sir Lee Teabing. Teabing is an anagram of Bagent. Okay, these are the guys whose work Dan Brown ripped off for the Da Vinci Code. So if he wanted to get caught, he wasn't exactly hiding it. So in the book, this guy, Sir Lee Teabing, helps Professor Robert Langdon, who's kind of the hero, that's the Tom Hanks guy, of Harvard University. He's the symbologist. So Teabing helps Langdon interpret all these clues about the Grail and all this stuff. So Teabing in the book is just a fountain of misinformation, as my professor Craig Evans likes to say. So he wrongly says, oh, the Bible was actually put together by Emperor Constantine in the 4th century. That's not true. He claims that the Emperor Constantine pressured theologians of the church into saying that Jesus is divine, not human. That's also not true. And he also claims that there were 80 gospels. Okay, so if you read the Da Vinci Code, you might have heard this. He claims that there were 80 gospels, most of which the emperor ordered to be burned. So again, this idea the church is hiding stuff from you. That's kind of the idea here. So anyways, I can't even tell you how many things are wrong in this book. It is absolute nonsense. It's utter nonsense. And hopefully that should be enough to kind of let you know that there's nothing to see here when it comes to this alleged relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene.